got here too soon.
I went on perfect this morning, like this, right? Oh, yay.
I believe in the sun. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of his blood.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow.
Hello? Yeah. Well, as I said, if you didn't come last night, you missed a wonderful dinner. And I said to one of the people sitting at my table, well, ask me at the end, I'll rate the cook. And she said, well, what was it? I said, A+. So anyway, my sister came last night, and I want to share this moment with you. She was petrified when I got here. I said, what's wrong? She said she was coming down Jacobsburg Road, and with all that wind, she said the telephone pole came over to her side of the road. And she yells, Jesus, and it went back the other way and actually snapped. So she was thankful, and I'm thankful for that happening. Greetings. We welcome each of you to worship, and we share our response to what do you think is expected of disciples. Greet each other.
Thank you. From the book of Galatians, I am crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but it is Christ who lives in me.
Good morning. Yeah, in case you haven't guessed, we've discovered this week that we've been having trouble with different microphones. So if all of a sudden someone's up here talking and you're not hearing them, just take a deep breath and we'll try to figure it out. But we've had to do some changes, and we're probably going to have to call the company that originally installed it to come and check everything out. So just that as a brief word of whatever, public service announcement. We are all welcomed into the church through the sacrament of baptism. Donald and Aaron Clemens and Larry and Donna Palmer have been led by the Holy Spirit to affirm their baptisms and to claim their covenantal relationship with Christ, and in particular with the members of St. John's. They are here for service to Jesus Christ using the gifts which the Holy Spirit bestows. I now invite them to come forward. This is the part where all of you who are still sitting out there can either do your most welcoming smile and expression on your face, or a flinty-eyed glare, whichever spirit is moving you this morning. I'll go this way. The whole crew. I know I'm scary this morning, Sawyer. What can I say? It happens. When you get to be my age, you might be scary too. So, Aaron and Donald and Donna and Larry, do you profess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and do you desire to affirm your baptism into the faith and family of Jesus Christ? If so, please respond, I do.
I do.
Do you promise by the grace of God to be Christ's disciple, to learn from the wisdom of the Scriptures, to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God? Do you also promise to grow in the Christian faith and to be a faithful member of the Church of Jesus Christ, celebrating Christ's presence and furthering Christ's mission in all the world? If so, please respond, I promise with the help of God. Do you promise to participate in the life and mission of St. John's, sharing regularly in the worship of God and supporting the ministry and mission we seek to offer our community and the world? If so, please respond, I promise with the help of God. I would like to invite everyone to rise in body or in spirit as we affirm our faith, which will be up there. Let us unite with the church in all times and places in confessing our faith in the triune God. Do you believe in God? Do you believe in Jesus Christ? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? Let us, the members of St. John's United Church of Christ, express our welcome and affirm our mutual ministry in Christ. We welcome you with joy in the common life of this church. We promise you our friendship and prayers as we share the hopes and labors of the Church of Jesus Christ. By the power of the Holy Spirit, may we continue to grow together in God's knowledge and love and be witnesses of our risen Savior. You all may be seated, not you all yet. Let us pray together. Once we get rid of the picture, there we go. O God, we praise you for calling us to faith and for gathering us into the church, the body of Christ. We thank you for your people gathered in this local church and rejoice that you have increased our community of faith. Together may we live in the Spirit, building one another up in love, sharing in the life and worship of the church, and serving the world for the sake of Jesus Christ. So, in case you haven't figured it out yet, this is Larry, this is Donna. They come to us from New Creation Church in Easton. And this is Landon and Sawyer and Aaron and Donald, who Aaron, at least, used to be here, and then when they got married, they moved far abroad to Philadelphia. and joined, and actually they were UCC missionaries to a Presbyterian church, and they joined the Presbyterian church, and then they have moved back in the area, and so we are thrilled and welcome all of you, and you all may be seated. You all get to welcome them after worship. So, yep, you're welcome. It wasn't that bad, was it?
Today's word comes from Luke 24, verse 36b to 48. While they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do your doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of boiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witness to these things."
Any children like to come up for children's time? How are you guys today? Good? Hello again. How many of your parents read you stories? Your parents read you stories? Do your parents read you stories? Yes, we do. Well, I could read you a story. In fact, I think this is a great one. It's called "This I Know, Seeing God in the World We Made." But I want to try something different today. I want us to make up a story. So if you could make up a story about a magical creature, what would it be? What's your idea? A magical what?
Bird.
A magical bird. Can we do that? A magical bird? Okay, a magical bird. And Sawyer, what's this magical bird's name? I'm hard of hearing. Do we have one? Do you have a name? All right. Arthur, you got a name for a bird? George? George the bird. Okay. So what color is George?
Purple.
Purple. George the purple bird. Does George have a superpower?
Yes.
What's his superpower?
He can shapeshift.
He can do what?
Shapeshift.
Shapeshift? Yes. Whoa, okay. I'm glad this wasn't a thing when my kids were small. All right, so let's see. Once upon a time, there was a big or small purple bird.
Small.
A small purple bird named George. He lived in a cave near Nazareth. One day, a giant octopus came into town. And George had to figure out how to save Nazareth from the octopus. So he shapeshifted into
a snake.
He shapeshifted into a snake. And he slithered up to the bird. Not the bird. He slithered up to the... You got to help me with this story. To the octopus. And he said... What did he say to the octopus? What do snakes say? So the snake, he said to the octopus, and the octopus said, "You talking to me?" And George, the purple bird, now a purple snake, right, said, "Yeah, I'm talking to you. We need you to leave town because you're scaring people." And so the octopus, all right, what'd the octopus do?
He said no.
He said no? Okay, he said no. So what did George say? So George said, "Shoot." Because George is a family-friendly bird. So what was he going to do next? He shapeshifted into... What are octopuses afraid of? A whale? Shark? So a killer whale. A great white shark. So George changed into a great white shark. And then what happened? He said, "Get away or else." Well, no, not really. He probably said, because don't they need water to live? Oh, but he's magic. All right. So, you're going to go home and think about this. You're going to go home and say, our silly pastor told a silly story about a bird that could become a snake, that could become a killer shark, that tried to scare an octopus out of Nazareth and then went back to his cave. And you're going to finish the story, right? The reason we did this is because Jesus asks us to tell a real story to people about how he lived and about how God loves us. But guess what? Just like the story about George, the great big shape-shifting purple bird, right? We have to finish the story and tell it to people. Thanks for coming up, and thanks for helping me out. And if you think of something else that George did by the end of church, let me know before you leave. Okay? You can go back. I wonder if his last name was Brendel. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for this day, for this little burst of sunshine even. Thank you for your word. As we wade our way through it, be with us. Help us to sense your presence. Amen. As I've told you before, Lisa and Lisa and I love to watch reruns of the television show The West Wing, which started in 1999 and ran through 2006. And one of the iconic lines in the show was, "What's next?" You think about those two words or that question, "What's next?" It was a great transition between scenes and storylines. It also communicated something of pace. Like the president or someone always asking, "What's next?" Like there's always a next. Or even that is kind of backed up at times saying, "We're too busy to do one thing at a time. So what's next on my agenda? What's next here? What's next here? That problem solved. What's next?" Think about the times in your life when you say or think or utter, "What's next?" Do you often mutter "what's next" when you're down to your last nerve? What I mean by that is, I just got pulled over by a police officer for speeding, and when I went to hand him my registration and my insurance information, I realized that my insurance expired last week. And when I went to pull away from where the police officer stopped me, my car started belching black smoke. What's next? So you might have those situations in your life where "what's next" is kind of a plea for it all to stop. You might utter "what's next" most often when you have a really long to-do list. All right, bathrooms cleaned, beds made, grocery shopping done, table set, grass cut, what's next? Because you're making your way through this list of all these things you have to do. Sometimes you may be saying "what's next" in a good way. "I just won a $43 million Powerball jackpot. What's next? I just graduated with an MBA. What's next? I just got a new job. What's next?" We can ask "what's next" in all different ways and settings in our lives. How about, "I just prayed with my neighbor. What's next? I just finished reading all four Gospels. What's next? I just went and volunteered at Loaves and Fishes. What's next?" How often do we ask the question "what's next" in our life of faith, in the way that we practice our faith? The story that we have today is a story in Luke's gospel. Last week we read a story in John's gospel about Jesus' appearance after the resurrection. The disciples are in a locked room. They are afraid. This is the group of people who gave up their previous lives, their occupations, their whatever, and followed the one who promised them that he would teach them how to fish for people. And now they find themselves in a locked room because he's been crucified. He's not with them anymore, and they are not at all sure about what's next. They're hearing stories, perhaps, like that. This happens on what we call Easter evening, that women went to the tomb and found it empty. And then two of the followers of Jesus were walking back to Emmaus from Jerusalem, and they were accompanied by Jesus, but they didn't realize it until they were almost to their destination and invited him to stay. And they realized it was Jesus when he sat down to a meal with them, and so they ran all the way back to tell the disciples. And while they're telling the disciples who are in a locked room, all of a sudden, Jesus is with them. No knock on the door or no shout of greeting, just all of a sudden, Jesus is with him, and they think they are seeing a ghost. Who wouldn't? Right? In a room with locked doors, they think they're seeing a ghost. And Jesus says to them, "Why do you doubt and why are you afraid?" And he shows them his hands and he shows them his feet. And then he says, "Have you got something to eat?" which only goes to show that the disciples were not Pennsylvania Dutch. Because if they were Pennsylvania Dutch and they're gathered on a Sunday night, you know there's food involved. So Jesus asked them, "Do you have something to eat?" And they hand him fish and he eats it. Why? To prove that he's not a ghost. To prove that he's a real being with a body that can eat food and that can talk to them. And they start to relax a little bit. And so he explains the scriptures to them. He explains and opens it all up and their understanding, right? And they're all in this room. And then what is he has to go and spoil it all because he says, "You are witnesses." What do witnesses do? Jesus is laying out for them and for us a way of life. You are witnesses. How many times do we think what's next in terms of our faith? How many times do we prefer to live our life like we're in the witness protection program? That we don't want people to know who we are, or it's too much energy for people to know who we are, or we're not even sure what that means. One of the biblical commentators, I'm sorry, her name is not jumping out at me right this moment, but she said one of the ways that you can ask or that you can answer the question of how we should be witnesses is to find out what your community needs. What good news does your community need to hear? What ministry does your community need offered? And when you can answer those questions, you will begin to understand what it means to be a witness of Jesus Christ. That each of us has a command, an invitation, an expectation. You help me pick the word about what you think Jesus expects of us. Do you think Jesus expects of us that we gather to hear the gospel for our own personal benefit, that it is a resource to us for our living, that somehow it is up to us to receive it or not? It is up to us to live with it, and our neighbors and everyone else, well, that's kind of up to them. Jesus doesn't give us any responsibility to talk with them. Or is our witnessing something else? Is the reason that we're gathered here so that we can encourage each other, so that we can, as a unit, as a whole group, reach out to our community with ministries of hope? Jesus told them that they were to talk about repentance and forgiveness and grace and love and mercy. I just prayed with my neighbor. What's next? I just worked at the soup kitchen. What's next? I just sat with someone who wasn't sure that life is worth living because they didn't think that anyone else cared about them. I just performed a random act of kindness. I just helped someone feel better or at least feel understood. I think all of those are ways that we witness that Jesus has gathered us here for a purpose beyond our own learning and understanding. That we gather in a room that's not locked and that we expect to go out into the world. So as we leave today, What's next? Amen. We come to that time in our service where we offer God our gifts. It includes our money, but it also includes our life energy and our witness. So let us bring our gifts to God. I will be up here if you have any prayer requests.
Can escape disappointment, can avoid the delay, but I don't have to make feeling down and defeated the place that I stay. Gonna rise to the moment, gonna speak to the waves, gonna push back the doubt that keeps dragging me down when I can't find a way. Don't need to see it,
eyes on you,
to believe it,
my breakthrough,
before you even move or make a way. I will stand in faith,
eyes on you,
walk by faith,
for my breakthrough,
sleep by change. See miracles happen that no one can fathom as heaven invades. And it's more than a feeling, and it's anchored in praise. And when it's the darkest, it reaches the farthest and opens a way. Don't need to see it,
eyes on you,
to believe it,
for my breakthrough,
before you even move or make a way. I will stand in faith,
eyes on you,
walk by faith,
for my breakthrough,
live by faith,
before you.
Ooh, I believe, I believe, I believe. Stand in faith,
eyes on you,
see by faith,
for my breakthrough,
see by faith,
before you.
Ooh, I believe, I believe, I believe. This is how blind men get their sight. Start to rise. This is how small things multiply. Nothing's impossible. Nothing's impossible. This is where oceans have to part. This is where the light breaks through the dark. This is where I see who you are. Nothing's impossible. Nothing's impossible. Stir my faith. Stir my faith. I will stand in faith.
We have received prayer requests for Vita, for Bill S., Billy, Brenda A., Janice P., Cheryl E., Jackie M. and family, Zach, Ron, Chris A., Janine N., Ariel M., Margaret, Samantha, Gwen, Judy B., Sean, Jane J., Jared B., Carol N., Frank K., Barb L., Grace C., Winnie H., Dorothy S., Doris H., Rain, Larry K., Stephen F., for John, for Linda M., for Ed W., for Lewis. Prayers for families in a time of bereavement, for the family of Diane, the family of Ellen Bartholomew, family of Charmaine Ashenfelder, Mark Keeler and family on the loss of his brother Raymond. Let us join our hearts and minds in a time of prayer. Thank you, Lord, for your love. Thank you for reaching out to us, for sending your Spirit among us, for being present with us even in this moment. Thank you for faith, for belief, for wonder, and for awe. Thank you for your Son, for the gift of life and eternal life, for forgiveness and grace and mercy and love. Thank you for your healing in our lives. Thank you for all the people whose names we have lifted up, people who will live in our memories and in eternity, people who are seeking healing or strength for the living of these days, people whose lives matter to us in special ways. We come to you, Lord, feeling gathered in your hands, praying with thanksgiving, praying for wisdom, praying to know how to live into what's next, praying to have courage and strength, to be witnesses in every way we can think of, to share reconciliation and love and peace with the world. We come to you. Hear our prayers. And hear us as we pray together. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Everybody rise and join with us.
Everybody falls sometimes. It's gotta find the strength to rise from the ashes. It's more than you can take, but you're stronger, stronger than you know. Don't you give up now, the sun will soon be shining. You've got to face the clouds to find your silver lining. Just happen, silent prayers get answered.
On Christ's solid rock I stand, all the other ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock. On Christ's solid rock I stand, all the other ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock.
And I'll feel my hope about to break. I will cling to your unchanging
Sing it if you know it. The key part in that I wanted you to hear was, I'm a believer. The key part I wanted you to get out of that is, for many of you, there was a smile on your face. Perhaps it made you feel younger as you remembered earlier days, or perhaps it was just the infectious part of the music. One of the comments under the video is, I was dancing to this in the supermarket the other day. Right? Because it's one of those songs. So why, Jeff, did you play that? Because that's how I would love for us to go out into the world with a smile on our face, singing, I'm a believer, and have it be infectious. So let's think about that as we go out into the world, being on the lookout for purple birds named George, who are also trying to change the world. Rather than make them stand and process, I'm going to invite you to make sure that you welcome Larry and Donna and Aaron and Donald this morning and then share in our refreshments. So go in peace with a spring in your step.